is actually my first time speaking in India. So I'm excited to go ahead and take this opportunity to come back and share my story. Even though this conference is about digital media, and I'll be talking a little bit more about that on tomorrow's panel, I thought that today we can make this a little bit more interesting. Since you know, my entire story, while it revolves around my success as an entrepreneur in digital media, the book that I basically wrote shortly after Blue Lithium was called The Dream. And there's basically a key message there, and it's all about how one can actually achieve their dreams. So I hope to share that story a little bit, as well as tell you a little bit about some of the mistakes I made and some of the lessons I learned from there, and hopefully inspire others to also reach their dreams. I guess to give you a little backdrop on the actual book, my nephew is actually 7 years old, and he's actually way older than his actual age. And he actually asked my sister, saying one day, "I actually want to read G's book." That's what he calls me. And so at bedtime, she started reading a few pages. And there was one page with one line that he kept reading over and over. And it resonated to a seven-year-old. So I figured that if it connected with him, it has the ability to connect with others. And those words were, "If he did it, so can I." So just to give you a little bit about me, I was born in India, Punjab, Tarantara. I immigrated to the US a year after my parents did, and basically came a month shy of four. That whole phrase, fresh off the boat, was pretty much the epitome of my family trying to connect in America. The social adaptation was pretty much a big challenge that that we faced. But my parents came to America as with one belief, and that was that it was the land of opportunity. And I think a lot's changed in India today, where it's probably the land of opportunity now, but back then, every immigrant's dream was to come to America. And if you came to America, you could basically reach your dreams. So even with the racial stereotypes, even with the issues that we faced, we never really forgot the reason why we actually came to America. And that was to go ahead and take that chance and take that opportunity that was given to us. So, kind of fast forward, you know, I fell in love with the internet, as weird as it may sound. I was an outsider as a child, but the internet was kind of my way of connecting. And you know, there was one key thing that I realized in the internet that the power gave us is the fact that you're in front of a machine and you're connecting with everyone out there, and nobody needs to know you're 16. And you're basically probably, you know, physically, you know, probably not in the same degree to do business, but on the computer, on the internet, you can be whoever you want. And on the internet, the only thing that really matters is one key thing, which is results. So I went to work. I started my first internet advertising company called Click Agents. And I was largely fascinated by one company after watching CNBC. And it was called DoubleClick. And I basically saw it go from an overnight success. And I remember, you know, basically looking in the CNBC, the IPO day, and it became a $300 million company. And the next day it became a $1 billion company. And I basically said, you know, wow, you know, look at all these different internet companies that are growing up and actually starting overnight. Why not me? You know? And I started thinking about ways to go ahead and do it myself. In between, my parents basically hit a financial issue. And in that financial collapse, you know, we all had to go ahead and do a little bit more. So my sisters basically took jobs, my brother took a newspaper route, and before I started this company, the only interview in my life that I ever did was at McDonald's. And I was a 15-year-old, and I found a McDonald's in between my high school and my school, and I said, hey, you know, let's see if I can get a job and help out the family. Lo and behold, I didn't get the job, which is probably the best result I could imagine. And that motivated me more. Because you know what? I realized that rejection is something that you have to embrace. And I went to work in my bedroom, started this idea of advertising, did a deal with someone where I actually got the software to track the clicks and advertising and all this stuff, because I'm not a technical person at all. And I picked up the phone and I went to work. And within 30 days, I had my first deal. Within 90 days, I had over $100,000 in advertising booked. So, you know, it kind of tells you that when you have that inner desire of wanting to be successful and you make failure not an option, it resonates for you to go ahead and fight all the odds to go ahead and make things happen. So, fast forward, so 2 years later, I grew it to a very big company, 34 employees, and sold it at 3 months after I turned 18 for $40 million. And I stayed on as with my new company for about a year and a half. And as soon as my non-compete expired, I started Blue Lithium, which was competitive to click agents, but it was basically an ad network that was focused on behavioral advertising. And kind of fast forward 3.5 years later, grew into even a bigger company, 175 employees, offices worldwide, and sold that to Yahoo for $300 million. Interesting anecdote here is the fact that when I sold it, I was 25. But the entire world only found out I was 25 as soon as I saw the press release hit the wires, and I knew that there's no way of it going back. And I actually wrote an email to the entire world where I said that I feel blessed that at the age of 25, that I was able to do this twice in my life. So kind of fast forward, I had a 3-year non-compete the same way. I started a company called G-Wallet, which was focused on advertising on social games. And 3 days after my non-compete expired, I started Radium One, which competes with Blue Lithium, and basically ended up becoming the parent company of G-Wallet. So, I live and breathe the internet. I love the fact that I was able to, be able to achieve the success I've been able to do. And most importantly, I think the unique thing about me as an entrepreneur is that I stuck to what I was good at. And this is the third time, essentially, I'm in the same business, but I continued to innovate, and I got the chance 3 times to go ahead and have the success. So, tell you a little bit about the themes of my life. There's 3 things that I realized. And this is largely with the fact that my grandmother was a big part of my life. And she taught me 3 different themes that I stuck with. Sacrifice, struggle, and love. When it comes to sacrifice, success comes from wanting to win. So if you gotta want it bad. No shortcuts, pure sacrifice. And that means in education, even though I learned education not through school, but through the school of hard knocks, the career, as well as family. Struggle, those who dream and count on luck get surrounded by jealousy. Those who dream and let struggle drive them get surrounded by ambition. You have no idea how many times people have come up to me and I've actually read the headlines and said, wow, you got it pretty easy. And that kind of just, you know, it's kind of a slap in my face because, you know, there's a lot of struggle that went into that success. But that's the mindset some people choose to believe because they basically have that uniform of why him versus why not me trying to go ahead and achieve the same success on my own by adapting this struggle. And most importantly, the last part, love. And what I mean by love, if you have a choice between hatred or forgiveness, pick forgiveness because forward movement is everything. And this applies to life, this applies to the business world. And especially when you're in my shoes where you're a 16-year-old and you've never ever faced reality and don't have an MBA to back you up into the kind of decisions that you'll end up making, you will get screwed. So that's basically the epitome of how the business world works, is that if you get mustered around how do you go ahead and get back at someone versus realizing, okay, you know what, I got screwed, now what? How do I go ahead and go on with my life, pick up where I left off, and go from there? And actually, another quick story, one of my favorite lectures that I did was actually last year at the London School of Economics. And I was pretty impressed because I walked into the school and there was basically a whole line out of people, and I was kind of confused because I'm like, you know, I was expecting maybe 50, maybe 100 people. And there was basically 800 people that packed into this auditorium. And obviously there's a big Indian population, so there's a lot of Indians there as well. But shortly after this lecture, this guy came up to me and he said that, you know what, your story fascinates me because you can take the boy out of Punjab, but you can't take the Punjab out of the boy. And I kind of said, what do you mean by that? And he said that I'm a Sikh, so I can go ahead and tell you something that I learned from your story that actually applies to the mantras of Sikhism. And you must be tolerant to change. Always choose quality over quantity. Don't allow yourself to be vulnerable. And accept that everything happens for a reason. Who said business and religion didn't go hand in hand? But anyways, all of this applies to, you know, what we all go through day to day, and that is to wake up and make a choice. We can either choose to sleep or we can choose to go ahead and wake up and make our dreams come true. So I've picked about 10 life lessons that I've picked up that all around apply to universally everyone. So this doesn't really apply to just business. But I'd love to know just from this crowd, how many entrepreneurs do we have in the audience? All right, cool. And how many advertisers, agencies? And how many publishers? And how many press? All right, great. So I think the first audience will probably benefit the most. But here goes the first one. Anytime somebody comes up to me, and this is largely, I don't want to stereotype, but it's mostly Indians, but they come up to me and they basically say, you know what, give me an idea. You know, I just want that idea. If you give me that idea, I just, you know, they almost are obsessed with this idea that all it takes is this light bulb, and as soon as this light bulb happens, apparently you're going to get rich. And, you know, I sometimes basically, you know, came up with an answer saying, hey, if I had a great idea, why'd I give it to you, right? But the typical mindset, I think, that and to the people that are in business probably will resonate with me and connect that it's all about the execution. But going back to it, the myth of an idea is still a myth, right? How did you come up with that idea? First of all, let me go ahead and say all three of my companies, I am not that smart to come up with the idea. All I did is look at an idea and realize, how can I go ahead and out-execute this person and do it better, and then innovate. So you can say I copied an idea and I just did it better. But here's the thing. That might sound bad, but let's take a look at some of the biggest companies in the world today. Let's take a look at Google, for example. Google didn't invent search. You know, before Google, there was Yahoo. Before Yahoo, there was Alta Vista. Before Alta Vista, there was InfoSeek. There was all these different companies out there. Even look at Facebook today, one of the biggest internet companies today. And before Facebook, there was MySpace. Before MySpace, there was Friendster. All of these different iterations of social networking existed before. So this goes to the universal theme that, you know what, the person who gets it first doesn't matter. It's all about the person who gets it right. And 1% of the journey is just the idea. 99% is all in the execution of it. So one of my strategies I've always been with Click Agents, Blue Lithium, with Radium One is the fact that I launched the product, I got it to parity, I innovated then as the final step to separate from the pack. And that's really been the formula for most of the companies in the space. Keep the blinders off. Be open to change. Don't be obsessed on one direction or an idea. It will change. And if you get attached or obsessed with that idea, you're forcing something to survive. take the blinders off, look around. Don't be afraid to go off in all sorts of directions, since that's where you might just find the most unusual and promising ideas. So I remember my first presentations I did at Click Agents and Blue Lithium. And I had all these different ideas of all I wanted to do, but they were really essentially slideware. It was basically my, just like an artist has like a painting, it was basically my painting. PowerPoint's every entrepreneur's sketch point that you can basically imagine. And none of some of the things that I wanted to do didn't end up becoming true, just because they just didn't work. But I was open to the idea of change. I was open to the idea of realizing that, you know what, I have to constantly challenge myself to go ahead and make something different. Because if I do that, that's where I will go ahead and come up with the most most successful company. Now, even a primer example is the fact that when I decided to get back into the business and I started G-Wallet, which is a product, it originally was a consumer-facing coupon site. Tried it out for a month, realized it didn't get traction, completely changed it into social gaming, and boom, became a multi-million dollar business months after. So that basically tells you that how even a third-time entrepreneur can sometimes make mistakes, but it's not really mistakes, it's really a launching pad, right? And as soon as you're able to go ahead and realize what sticks, what resonates, what goes forward, you hit the accelerator button and you go for it. Surroundings. Surround yourself around people that want to see you succeed. Most people are like crabs. They see you scaling over the wall, and they do everything in their power to pull you down. And you know what, sadly, it's the truth. And it's probably the truth in every stereotype, so you can't just label it as one group. It's just the human nature of the way people work. So one of the things I realize is that in business, the first five people I hire will basically give me a chance to realize I will be successful. So if I hire the wrong five people, I'm out of business. The first 20 people I hire will actually give me the chance to let me realize whether I'm going to have a small business or a really, really big one. Because if you can instill that culture, if you can instill that DNA, if you can instill the confidence that people want in wanting to be successful, and you surround yourself around them, that's when you're going to go ahead and have the epitome of success. And one of my favorite quotes is the fact that you got to hire the smartest people you can find. Smart people make beautiful music together. Lots of smart people working in unison can have the power and beauty of a Beethoven symphony. Never keep yourself vulnerable. Never make someone have control of something in your business that can make you vulnerable. Consider everyone replaceable. If you don't, you'll end up in an unexpected situation where your destiny will no longer be in your own hands. Remember, I just said, hire smart people, hire the best people you can find, blah, blah, blah. But at the same time, I also, this is a very crucial point, because you don't want to hire people that can essentially take you out of business. It happened to me. I mean, I didn't have an MBA school degree at 16 to realize what trust was, how I can trust people. But, you know, that guy I hired to go ahead and create that software for me, and I ended up paying a lot of money for it, realized 6 months into it, wow, this guy actually has a real business. Because in 6 months, we were doing $300,000 a month in revenue. And he basically said, if you don't give me a third of the company, I'm going to shut you down. So I basically said, okay, shut me down. Trying to call his bluff, but I got shut down. And at 16, you don't have the resources of what to do. And you know what, the FBI is not really gonna go ahead and pick up your case because they have bigger things to do. So I had to go ahead and pick up where I screwed up and realize that, you know what, once I got back control of my business at 16, I realized that I have to hire some smart people. And I have to pay them really well. And I have to basically realize that I'm never going to go ahead and put myself in a vulnerable situation where somebody can just go ahead and do that to me. And that's, you know, probably a very instrumental lesson that you probably can't learn from textbooks, because it's the reality of trust, emotion, and people. Hunger. Surround yourself around people that want to see you successful, and most importantly, are hungry. I don't mean food-wise, but I mean in terms of appetite of wanting to see success. Too many people in this world want a handout. Money doesn't grow on trees, and you don't want to go ahead and just give your hard work to people that aren't going to put that ammunition in place. So be careful and only surround yourself around the right people. So one of the things I did in my second company is that I found a company in Belarus called Ad Revolver. I picked up the phone, and it was a Louisiana phone number. Louisiana is a state in America. And as soon as I dialed, it actually had this international dial tone happen. And I realized, okay, Louisiana is part of the United States. It should not have an international dial tone. It actually routed me to Belarus. And this thick Russian accent picked up the phone. And I talked, and I basically said, hey, I'm interested in talking to you about business and potentially taking a look at what you have. Within that week, I flew down to London, took a look at what they had, and then basically realized that they actually are in Belarus, Minsk, and they just have a 1-800 number that supposedly looks like a Louisiana number, but they're actually just scrappy entrepreneurs in Belarus, Minsk, but guys that have built some great technology. I flew out there, saw basically some of the scrappiest desks, the scrappiest offices and apartment buildings, and loved the adrenaline, and I loved the enthusiasm of the people that I saw there. So I basically made a deal. I asked him, what do you want for your business? He said, $500,000. I said, I ain't gonna give you that. But what I will give you is an opportunity to be a part of my company. So I'll give you wallpaper. This wallpaper is basically a vote of confidence to tell you that if you work hard, you will make a lot more money than $500,000, guaranteed. Well, not guaranteed, but you know, you get the drift. And he took that risk. Fast forward 3 years later, they got $15 million for that deal. Well deserved. I mean, I'm all about sharing the wealth. I'm all about surrounding yourself around the right people. But most importantly, the hardest thing for an entrepreneur to do is find out who's that hungry, to take that risk, work that hard, and in conjunction, have that success. Embrace rejection. Everything happens for a reason. Learn to accept rejection and embrace it. It will make you stronger. I learned that the hard way. I learned that in school. I learned that from being picked on. I learned that from being the odd one. And I also learned that in business. No one wanted to fund me at ClickAgents. And just to remind you, this was 12 years ago when it was the dot-com boom. This is where people were getting IPO'd. Millions of dollars were being raised over lunch simply because somebody had a dot-com idea. And I had a business that was making millions of dollars a year in revenue and profit, and nobody wanted to fund me. No one. Now fast forward at Blue Lithium, when I started my second company, and I had already had success written because of my last company, there was two times that I actually had people that gave me money, and then they pulled out the last minute. So, I mean, that's what investors are. They can do that. They didn't really even have the confidence back then to go ahead and fund me. So I had to embrace rejection. Eventually I raised $11.5 million the third time around. But I had to even adapt and embrace the fact that things happen for a reason. And I just got to go back to work harder, and prove people wrong. Other industry examples. You guys know who J.K. Rowling is? The most successful author worldwide. And she actually had, she created the Harry Potter series of books, which are now big, big movies. And she went to 6 different publishers for the first Harry Potter book. All said, psh, not gonna happen. You ain't gonna get it. The 7th publisher finally gave her a deal. So this is, just to remind you, the amount of success this author has had, no author worldwide ever has had. And she had to face rejection 7 times. You guys know who Magellan is? It's the original GPS company that is now sits in all these cars where you guys can punch in where you want to go. This person had a hell of a rejection thermometer. Actually, this person had it so well, I don't know how many people would actually be able to have the same type of appetite for it. He went out 86 times for funding. And he had this crazy idea that someday in cars, there will actually be GPSs, and people will want them. And most people said, never gonna happen, won't happen, 86 times. Till the 87th time, he got that original round of funding, which actually established a multi-billion dollar industry around GPS devices. Asking for help. Don't expect help from others until you realize you can give them something. I remember when I was young, actually, hopefully I'm still young, but I remember when I was younger, I would actually go around in conferences and, you know, look up to certain business personalities, and I would basically want their help, want their 1 hour of guidance or direction or their name on my website or whatever. And I realized that business doesn't work that way. Nobody is gonna give you anything until you bring something to the table. So when you ask for help, understand the business world is very primitive, and it's about what you can do for them. And if you can change the table, and you're actually in control, and you're giving them something, you can get whatever you want. So the objective here is, you wanna be able to provide someone of value first, so they wanna go ahead and, with open arms, help you with whatever you wanna do. Need versus necessity. Understand the difference between need and necessity. The dot-com world was the first example. The subprime mortgage fallout in 2008 is another example. Greed isn't good, and money is finite. Spend every dollar like it is your last. So, and realize the only thing that people will be impressed by is one thing, and that is your performance, and absolutely nothing materialistic. Exterior stereotypes. The number one characteristic any entrepreneur will need is confidence. And frankly, I didn't have that 12 years ago. Thank God there was a screen with a computer where I could type away. But eventually I got over that fear. 12 years ago, if you would have asked me to get up on stage and say this presentation, I'd be running out that door. But over time, over experience, you can go ahead and do that. So anytime I talk to introverts or anytime I talk to people that have that fear of connecting, I always say, just look at me. I was a prime example. Now I love being on stage. Before, I would be afraid of this environment. But that's the key thing, because if you can resonate confidence to people in the business world, in anything, you can get whatever you want. And the other key thing is that the fact that don't let the exterior stereotypes get in the way. The thing I learned early on is that, so what if I'm 16? So what if I dropped out of high school? So what I have all this exterior stereotype against me? It didn't matter, because so long as I could go ahead and keep the conversation about the business, keep the conversation about the performance, keep the conversation on the logistics, the misconceptions of who I was, how old I was, my education, all faded away. And one of the key, actually funny stories is the fact that when I actually decided to raise money and actually venture out and say, okay, let me start and see if I can get any investors. And I was 16, and I remember my first presentation I ever did. I thought I did an awesome job. And the first question I had was, so what'd you do before this? And I would always say, oh, middle school. But that didn't really connect that well with that investor group. So I learned the hard way that I gotta go ahead and make sure that I impressed them so well in the business world that they would never ask me what I did before. Relationships. So one of the things I realized is that another class that I taught was at Columbia University. And this was a hardcore MBA class that was all about numbers and stuff like that. And I was actually nervous because I sat in about 10 minutes before I got up on stage. And I basically said, either you guys are gonna love what I have to say, or you guys are gonna hate it. Because you know what? What you're learning here is just practical numbers. But the real world of business revolves around just one key thing, and that's relationships. So you will be successful in business if you understand and can connect with one word, and that is relationships. With your customers, with your employees, with everything else around that, it comes down to one key thing. The numbers don't change, they're not gonna lie. So you do need that. You do need to understand them. But the what's going to define your success is going to be the ideology of what you have when it comes to connecting with relationships, because they're everything in life, and most importantly, in the business world. Never burn a bridge as well. There have been many times I've been shut down, insulted, told that I was going to miserably fail, but I bit my tongue and I never burned a bridge. I let time and performance fix everything. Make decisions. Sometimes the problem in the business world lies on the fact that nobody makes a decision. And that's why big companies end up acquiring small companies, because in a small company, you can actually make some decisions and get traction and actually have a business up and running. Big companies fail to execute on just making decisions. And I even encourage people, make wrong decisions. Because if you make wrong decisions, you'll learn, hopefully, not to do them again, but you'll learn at least the ideas of making mistakes and never making them again. Negotiation and perception. If you need something from the other guy, you've already lost. People want what they can't have. Become the thing people want. So you always need to maintain a position of strength. When you start asking for things in a conversation, it's already game over. When you change the table around and you actually provide value from that perspective, you're gonna win. And always remember one thing, perception is reality. What they see is more important than what is. So show them what they wanna see and tell them what they wanna hear. Most conservative business people will not agree with me on this, but I'm not conservative. And I've always followed the philosophy that you gotta build a dream, you gotta sell the dream, and you gotta live the dream. And the way you do that, I mean, here's another example. Google is now a $200 billion company. When they were about a year, year and a half old, they landed the Netscape account. And I know you guys may not know what Netscape is now, but back then it was a pretty big company. And it had a lot of search traffic as well. So Larry Page and Sergey Brin basically landed the account. They were high-fiving each other. And then it went live. And then their servers crashed. And they realized that at the end of the day, holy crap, they weren't ready for it. But you know what? They didn't sit there crying and moping. They actually realized what they needed to do. And they bought time and they were able to execute and realize that they actually have a fundamental product that people want, and people want more of it, and they just got to prepare for it. Most people will go ahead and go into this process by saying, oh, we're not ready, we need 8 months to go and put this in place, blah, blah, blah. Business and time and money is not going to wait for you. It's simply not. What is going to wait for you is yourself. And you're either going to go ahead and wait and not execute, or you're going to go ahead and thrive at every opportunity that hits you. Thick skin. Grow a thick skin. A very, very thick skin. People will question your ability to succeed, and the loudest among them may make you doubt your own talents. So you'll need a thick skin to drown out the noise. The silence will help you focus on your objective and you will prevail. I had a board member at Blue Lithium, and in one of my board meetings, he basically came up to me and said, hey, you know what, G, I gotta tell you something. I'm like, what? He said, you know what, I think the company is growing a lot faster than you. And he had this internal vendetta almost with the basis of realizing that he didn't really know my age, but just assumed that I wasn't the typical 45-year-old white Ivy League typical CEO of Silicon Valley, and that just pissed him off. And he basically went on an outrage of basically going to the other board members and trying to actually remove me as CEO. And typically people could get into a fancy over that, but I realized that, you know what, I'm really good at this. This is my company. I've made decisions to get it this far, and I'm gonna go ahead and continue to make great decisions, because so long as I perform, nobody can touch me. And that's what I ended up doing. So final thoughts, my last two slides. Take the advice of the late great comedian, Jimmy Durante. Be nice to the people on the way up, because you will probably meet them on the way down. Do the work, keep your eye on the tiger, fight like hell, defy the odds.
It's worth it. Remember one thing, never compromise your morals. One of my favorite themes comes from one of the greatest CEOs of all time, Steve Jobs. And he said, stay hungry, stay foolish. And to me what that means, and it may mean something completely different to you, but to me what it means is never forget where you came from and never forget where you want to go. So my last slide, before I show you that, how many parents in the audience? All right, cool. So about a half. So one thing I want to be able to say is that, and I say this to a lot of people that have parents, and I basically said that parents have two things that they can do to their children, they can give throughout their life. Obviously, the first thing is the gift of life, and the second thing is the gift to dream. And all I gotta say is that when you guys are this age, you wanna be able to say you gave both. Thank you.